This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. I also want to give a special thanks to Aaron Mate, our headlines editor. We forbade him to come to work today because we couldn't get those headlines stuck in the snow. And to Mike Burke, who's in the snow-covered Boston. We're wishing your mother a speedy recovery. This is Democracy Now! As we turn now to the Ivory Coast, where a general strike has been called for today to force incumbent President Laurent Gbagbo to cede power. Gbagbo has refused to step aside following the disputed presidential election last month, which he claims was rigged. Opposition leader Alassane Ouattara has been widely recognized as the winner of the election. The United Nations, the European Union, the United States, the African Union and the West African Regional Bloc, ECOWAS, all say that Ouattara won the November 28th vote. A delegation of heads of state from Benin, Sierra Leone and Cape Verde is traveling to the Ivory Coast Tuesday to convince Gbagbo to step aside. Meanwhile, the president of ECOWAS threatened that the West African bloc may use force to remove Gbagbo from power.
Season of peace, the summit decided to make an ultimate gesture to Mr. Gbagbo by urging him to make a peaceful exit. In this regard, the authority decided to dispatch a special high-level delegation to Cote d'Ivoire. In the event that Mr. Gbagbo fails to heed this immutable demand of ECOWAS, the community would be left with no alternative but to take other measures, including the use of legitimate force to achieve the goals of the Ivorian people.
President Gbagbo's security forces have been accused of orchestrating some 200 deaths, hundreds of arrests, dozens of cases of disappearances and torture in recent weeks. Some 14,000 people have already fled to neighboring Liberia, and the UN says it's prepared for a total of 30,000 refugees in the region. In Washington, State Department spokesperson P.J. Crowley said Gbagbo must step down.
The certified results irrefutably show that President-elect Ouattara was the winner. Credible, accredited, and independent election observers have declared the election to be fair and reported no incidences of fraud that would change the outcome as announced by the Electoral Commission. Mr. President Gbagbo must accept the results of the election. From our standpoint, this is not negotiable. President Gbagbo also claimed that the current situation in Cote d'Ivoire has been peaceful. This is untrue. The international community is documenting widespread human rights abuses occurring in the country, from home abductions to a feared mass grave in Abidjan.
For more, we're joined on Skype by Horace Campbell. Now, Skype had a global blackout last week, and we hope that we're able to maintain this connection. Horace Campbell is professor of political science and African studies at Syracuse University, but he's joining us from North Carolina, which is also in a state of emergency right now because of the blizzard. Just before we talk about Ivory Coast, what is it like in North Carolina, in Raleigh, Professor Campbell?
I'm actually in Winston-Salem, and I'm actually surprised because we have less than 3 inches of snow here in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. I'm from Syracuse, and in the last 2 weeks, we had 71 inches of snow in Syracuse. But we are a bit hard in Syracuse. We have a long history of resistance and hard work. The Peace Council is 75 years in Syracuse, 75 years old. So I'm actually very surprised to see that on the ground here, I'm looking outside the window, there are less than 3 inches of snow, and I hear that there's a state of emergency because of 3 inches of snow. Coming from Syracuse, that is amazing to me.
Well, it's always amazed me, even in Washington, D.C., that it seems like when there's a snowflake, the entire capital shuts down. But speaking of adversity, let's turn right now to the Ivory Coast, which certainly is in the midst of a firestorm. Explain what is happening there. Talk about the elections and what took place, Professor Campbell.
Well, this is a test for the African Union. It's a test for whether the concept of people's rights and the idea of democracy will go beyond elections. Because in the case of the Ivory Coast, that is called Cote d'Ivoire, we have a situation where the person who has lost the election, Lauren Gbagbo, is refusing to step down. And in the process of refusing to step down, he and those around him, they are invoking all forms of xenophobia and hostility to people from the North in order to divide the country. Thankfully, the days when Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea were places that could provide the mercenaries so that Gbagbo could develop war. Thankfully, we are in a state of transition in in Sierra Leone, in Liberia, and Guinea, so that the possibility for war will be dependent on the extent to which Gbagbo can get support from persons like Lanny Davis in the United States and the bankers and financial elements within the country that will finance his army. The position of the African Union, the position of ECOWAS, the position of the United Nations is clear that the elections were won by Alassane Ouattara and that Gbagbo should step down. Gbagbo is doing what Mugabe has done in Zimbabwe and that Kibaki did in Kenya. When you lose elections, you use the powers of the state to say the elections are rigged, and then you maintain power by force. The African Union is taking a very strong position in the case of Ivory Coast, and what we're dreading is the actual military confrontation, which has been promised by ECOWAS. As you played in the clip, it said that they will use credible force. We're hoping that sanctions and the rising by the working peoples will be enough to bring down Gbagbo. What we have to do in this country, we have in this country to call on Hillary Clinton to distance herself from Lanny Davis, who has been employed by Gbagbo, to lobby for him in Washington to present the government as a transparent and democratic government.
You mentioned Lanny Davis. We had him on in a debate around the coup that led to the ouster of the democratically elected leader of Honduras. He was a spokesperson for those who supported the coup in Honduras. Explain exactly what his role is in the Ivory Coast and who he is, his significance in U.S. democratic politics.
Well, it's not in U.S. democratic politics. It's the Clinton faction of the Democratic Party politics. And he's been an advisor to Bill Clinton, and he remains close to the Clintons. Lanny Davis has a lobbying firm. Right now, he's employed by one of the worst dictators in Africa, Nguema Clique, that has ruled Equatorial Guinea for 30 years. This is a government that has vast wealth from oil companies whose children own mansions in California, where banks in Washington, D.C. Holds money that should be used for water supplies and health for the people of Equatorial Guinea. Now, this government in Equatorial Guinea employed Lanny Davis, who is a lobbyist in Washington, to present an image of these dictators in Equatorial Guinea that could be sold to the corporate elements in the United States of America. As you rightly pointed out, when the coup took place in Honduras, Lanny Davis also represented the militarist elements there. It is this track record that has endeared him to the Gbagbo forces whose elements have millions of dollars, have also used the money that should be used for the people of Ivory Coast to employ Lanny Davis. And what we should see is Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton should distance themselves from such a person, because the United States cannot, in one breath, say that they're supporting transparency and accountability. That's the words that have been used by Lanny Davis in Africa, while they are allied with persons such as this who support dictators in Africa.
We're talking to Professor Horace Campbell.